Thank you, Paula. We are going to leave a question for the end. Our next speaker now is Ioannou from the University of Chile.
Many thanks for being here. My presentation is titled Schematic Motivation, Constructions and Prototypicality in Discourse, from Field to Date in Ancient Greek. It is a corpus-based diachronic semantic analysis of the verb plero in Ancient Greek, originally meaning field, which follows its evolution from the 6th century BC to the 3rd century CE. It tries to meaningfully link three tiers of conceptual projections as relevant to the evolution of a lexical sense: image schematic motivation, constructional schemes, and finally, textual themes. It implements the so-called behavioral profile approach as a way of dealing methodologically with the fuzziness of lexical senses demarcation, the very reason underlying policing and language states in the first place. It uses exploratory statistical techniques such as multiple correspondence analysis, which are not that much about hypothesis testing, but about exploring structure in the data. Behavioral profile can be defined as patterns of concurrent factors that populate an entrenched region on a space of conceptual possibilities. This populated region reflects the notion of sense, to which we activate access through the phonological form of a symbolic unit. Now, when I speak about phonological pole, I more generally include the externalization of the symbolic unit, so that I may include constructional schemas as well as a perspectivization of the semantic frames expressed through the senses. In this light, part of the difficulty in defining a lexical sense would lie in the following fact. Many times, senses are not defined just as patterns of factor concurrences, but also, so simple collocations, but also as interactions of patterns or sub-patterns of factor configuration. My data comes from manual annotation of 4,600 instances of the verb plero from 6th century BC to the 4th century CE, extracted from Thesaurus Linguae Graecae Corpus at the University of California. The formal and semantic features I have coded for are the following: agent, patient, filler, conjunction, tense, voice, and constructional code. So a coded list looks like this. And in this connection, there are three questions that arise. How much of all possible interactions can be really explained? What is lost in the way to a meaningful representation? Too much is lost. And third, what weighing criteria will we use in first place that regulate our measurements? What is the underlying linguistic theory somehow that we're using? As you can see here, for example, I have a rather fine-grained distinction between the semantic participants, and this is not an innocuous decision. It has to do with wanting to find the schematic motivation behind the senses, for example, in the semantic participants, as well as the relevance of discourse themes. So MCA, multiple correspondence analysis representations, collapse a multi-dimensional space into a lower dimensional representation. Plero, in its prototypical and historically prior sense, means field, as we can see through the distribution of plero as field across the centuries. So somehow we want to say that the contained image schema is relevant to the sense of field as well as the schematic construction that sanctions it. So embedding the image schema, trying to embed the image schema into the construction, we may say that we have an element which is the container, which participates in two relations. The one relation is the trajector, who is acting over the container, and the other is the second trajector, which is the filler. So we have the interesting case where the element of the container participates in two relations. Not one with the first trajector, and the second with this, and the second relation, the second trajector, which is the filler expressed in genitive. So MCA map looks like this. There's too much information there, which is not easy to decipher because, as I said, we have a dimensional space that somehow is flattened onto a background. Looking a bit closer, we have here two dimensions of the 4, 5, 6, sometimes 7 dimensions that are contributing to the variation. The one is the vertical one, and the other one is the horizontal, the second dimension. So, through a closer look here, immediately we can see that there is a polarization between active and passive bodies with the co-occurring features of the co-occurring constructional schemes of SOG and SG, subject, object, genitive, and subject, genitive. There is nothing special here. There is possibly a statistical triviality as well, but I have kept the features because after the image is changing. The third feature that I want to draw your attention to is that I have a quasi-reflexive sense as well, very limited for the 5th, 6th century, which concerns natural objects like the moon. So a moon is full, and by fills the moon is not filled by anything. So it is instructive to see the dimensions as well that underlie the variation, first, second, third dimension. These actually present us with the coefficients of association of the different variables to the variation, as well as the contribution and the strength of the instantiations of these variations, of these variables, of these factors. So here, nothing really surprising is going on. We have a polarization between the passive and the active voice, but there is something interesting. It is that the prototypical schema that is associated with active voice is not SOG, as I said before, but actually SO. Also, a second thing is that we have a very specific semantic participant here that features as relevant. So we have constructions, we have utterances, like the Athenians were filling the boats were obviously filled by people. The richest ones secured 8 boats each, after Phocians filled the 6th, etc. The same pattern is met with patients like heart, like vein, like theater, like court, etc. So a standard variation pattern that arises, first of all, omits the filler argument when the latter is recoverable by the semantic nature of the container itself. So somehow we have a kind of demotion of the filler argument. So the two prototypical constructions that first arise are the SG and the SO. This omission implies a shift of construal from the filler argument to the container's boundary, surfacing as the SO scheme. The filler argument somehow fuses with the inherent dynamics of the container to be filled. This situation gives rise to a container schema variation with container being projected as a telic state of the filler. And this, in turn, gives rise to the generalization of its transitive use as complete that incrementally becomes present in the plots. So for the next century, the picture is just the same, as we can see, with some variant there of FG that means actually the filler being expressed in dative. Yeah, and I want to draw your attention to the fact that we have incrementally the tendency of various meanings being attracted towards the reflexive sense. The picture continues that way for the 3rd century BC, where we see again the same tendency. You see that verbs that actually mean completion, like complete, culminate, augment, reach, fill up, fulfill, etc., are attracted towards the reflexive sense. For the first century now, very interestingly, we see that already the polarization between the passive and the active has disappeared. Now, the contrast holds between passive and reflexive. So, we have, as I said, first a demolding process of the feeler, and now, slowly, slowly, we have a demolding process as well of the subject as an agent that acts upon the container. So we have a general tendency of discursively highlighting or featuring something that is a patient than an agent. Okay? And also we have this tendency of the reflexive sense to become lexicalized with its own nominative case as a subject. And if we see the concentrational uses for the categories of voice for that period, we're going to see very neat picture. This picture actually represents, you can say, prototypicality of distribution, taking as a reference point a very specific variable. So we can see that there is no overlapping. This is precisely a tendency towards prototypization. And if you compare it with other sensors, you are going to see how much neater this picture is in comparison to the rest. So the picture essentially is identical for the next two centuries until we come to the first century at sea, where we have again the opposition between reflexive and passive, but also we have subjunctive as featuring elicity being added to the picture. So we have actually a very inclusive set that has reflexive as voice, no filler of course, subjunctive and past. Now we have as well some semantic participants that are very important, which is time as patient and speech as patient. We're going to see below the relevance of it. Now, this is a chaos, so increasing the sense